I'm pretty nice until you get to know me and you see what I'm really like. See all the out of control things that I do to other people and myself.
I started out as a painter and a sculptor, I guess, as a teenager, was really drawn to art after, I guess, being kind of a what I thought was like a failed scientist or something.
First, Deleuze suggests that the social conditions structuring my artwork take their cues from the very technologies that I'm making art about, both their inner workings and their outer objectives. As Deleuze writes, quote, types of machines are easily matched with each type of society. Not that machines are determining, but because they express those social forms capable of generating them and using them. So we can understand something about the social conditions of our lives by examining, as Deleuze does so prophetically, how machines disseminate qualitative affordances in social experience.
Things get appropriated all the time. For me, it's maybe a question of who's doing it and what the context is and what, you know, the imagined purpose would be.
New knowledge and modes of learning derive from our ability to understand power relations, but also how they affect the ways in which individuals come to understand themselves. If we think about how different powers that are connected with neoliberalism and with capitalism in general are increasingly targeting and profiting from our fears, from our affects and desires, passions, and even from our ability to relate to ourselves and to others.
In retrospect, it seems like my work is an alchemical process. It springs from disturbance. The initiating seed of everything I do is some kind of disturbance. And it's whatever is the most prevalent disturbance at any given moment.
Figure out how much I need to earn to survive. So when you go into the negotiation, and you're like, oh, I don't know, yeah, that sounds good. And then you get home and you do the calculation and you like divide it by 12 and you divide, you know, that by 4 and you're like, shit, it sounded good when it was just all one big number, but now I break it down. I can't fucking live on that. So you gotta know, going into the negotiation, what you want.
In our plasma class, we had the chance to see a performance by Cynthia Hopkins, and she was able to seamlessly transition to a different persona and really, you know, engage the audience with that. And I believe in fashion, based on the outfit you wear or how you style yourself, you're able to achieve the same thing. You can make a person perceive you differently by how you dress, even before they know anything about your personality.
Right.
I'm really excited by that sort of intersection between fiction and narrative and, you know, reality, the way we tell our stories.
The scripts began to write themselves because I started to think of each character as just part of the script. And when 4 or 5 of them got together, they would be saying something that I didn't actually write.
In the last decade or so of museum practice, you've seen a lot of 60s performance, which was so foundational in the US happenings and Fluxus and John Cage and Judson Dance Theater, being more understood and canonized in the museums. And there's been great exhibitions of all these forms. I think the 80s, like the East Village, Cabaret, No Wave, world also is a little more legible because it's more present in a way, and you know, that still kind of feels like the contemporary moment.
Essentially, I consider myself a storyteller, but the stories I tell are convoluted, and they're multifaceted, and they exist in all different kinds of psychological and physical spaces.
In this piece, Shakespeare himself would be grinning from ear to ear.
In organizing a show like this, I was really conscious that of not only who you include, but who you don't include. And so I wanted to make it really clear that this was a very thin slice of like my interests and what I saw as artistic tendencies that would mean a lot to the present. But it's not a survey of all of New York in the 70s or all performance or any of these things. And so, you know, these exhibitions have a lot of weight on them, and there's a lot of, it's very political about, you know, who's included and excluded from museums. And so I wanted to try to create a frame that was, in a way, like as narrow as possible and really honest about what it was after. And so the title helped.
I also really appreciated Jay Sanders' presentation on curation, because that's another field that I had never really thought about as media art. I really had never thought about the field at all, and I never realized how much kind of goes into the curation of a display of art, and how kind of what you choose to present of the art kind of makes it art in itself.
You know, just this like exhuming the set, and they had sort of had a plot, and the narratives of them are crazy because it's like nothing happens and everything happens. But the people that saw them, like Jonas Mikas, who ran the anthology film archives and wrote for the Village Voice, or Stefan Brecht, who was this theater critic, like write these tale. The narratives of these are like it's the most illuminating thing they'd ever seen in their whole lives.
Contemporary digital technologies are really easy to take for granted, both because we are reliant on them for so many things that it would be almost impossible to sort of pause and recognize them at every step of the way. We are both faced with this, this super accelerated obsolescence cycle with objects, but also, you know, it sets up a way of relating to ourselves. It's basically, you know, it's like, historical memory lapse, kind of, right? Like it's our inability as a culture to retain a sense of history.
And you know, you could make the argument that rather than being, you know, totally original, most of the things we see in culture come from somewhere else. And you know, there's a kind of long history of debate, you know, about whether it's appropriate or how, you know, how long you should go without letting the reader know that something is taken from another context. And it, you know, I suppose opens up, you know, to questions of, for instance, plagiarism, right? And questions of when something is misused, kind of by definition.
I've worked with the Yanomami tribe and in the Amazon on this project, and incorporated a lot of their imagery into this.
Arislor says he wants to break the hypnotic trance of commercial culture, even on non-commercial TV, with something subversive that asks viewers to participate.
People will spend 2 hours in a Hollywood movie that you could sum up in 10 seconds. So I think it's a matter of priorities and a different way of looking at time, really.
For a working artist like Beethoven to deliberately choose unpopularity is to deliberately choose potential poverty.
I think when you're creating art, you kind of have to get to know your audience, who's watching you, and I think that's the same thing when it comes to business. You have to target an audience, kind of, but for art, I wouldn't focus so much on the audience when I'm creating it, because it's more of like your work.
we all kind of perform every day. We kind of stage a different type of performance just so someone can watch us. It almost makes me wonder if, you know, anything I ever do is really for me or not to be, you know, perceived a certain way. I always thought that was interesting.
It turned out that what people really enjoyed about the process and the project was actually the ability to be in the space together and share knowledge and share skills and discuss challenges together. If we think about a world where social media and Web 2.2 pull everyone into this endless production of information objects that then are simply absorbed into cyberspace and don't necessarily lead to anything aside from an overproduction of information, they just really enjoyed the fact that they were not being forced to do anything beyond the, you know, what was being produced by the pleasure of being together and interacting.